let your body tell you. And the way you do that is you ask the question, and if your body moves forward, it's yes. If your body moves back, it's no. And in that moment, it could be the smallest movement, and you will notice that your body will move forward or back, even just a little bit. Sometimes for me, it's a lot, and I go, whoa. Okay. And then I don't let my mind come in, because the key is you can't let your mind come in after that, because you've just integrated mind, intuition, heart, energy field, body, the divine. And in that moment, all those aspects are working for you. So there's your answer.
Namaste. You're listening to the Savannah Podcast. Join us on an exploration of Eastern spirituality, yoga philosophy, and conscious living for the new age. This podcast is a production of SavannahSpirit.com, the best place to shop for unique clothing, spiritual handcrafted jewelry, healing gemstones, and fair trade gifts from the Far East. Now, here's your host, Brett Larkin.
Hello, Savannah family. Welcome back to the show. Today, we are continuing our conversation with Kundalini yoga teacher and healer, Karena Virginia. In Tuesday's episode, she presented this idea of our energy body, our auric field, actually having five layers. And she went into detail about that. I definitely encourage you to check out Tuesday's episode if you're interested in the eighth chakra, the auric field, or energy medicine, because there is fascinating content waiting for you in there. And in this episode today on Thursday, she's going to build on those concepts, but also share her personal story. She's going to share how she went through a period of loss and an awakening that happened after that, that really changed how she practiced and how she taught Kundalini yoga forever. She's also going to answer a lot of really amazing common questions on this episode. For example, how do we know if we're coming from our head or our heart? How can we ask for guidance from the universe when making really tough decisions in our lives? And she also answers the question, which I know I get asked on social media all the time, which is what to do if you have a triggering or negative reaction to Kundalini yoga. So you definitely want to stay tuned to listen and learn more. Remember, if you get value out of this podcast, if you learn things, would love it if you would give back and show your support. The two ways you can do that real quick are a rating or review here on iTunes, and you can go to savannahspirit.com/review to learn how to leave a review on iTunes, even if iTunes isn't how you normally listen to the show. And the second way is to make a purchase on savannahspirit.com. And you know I have that podcast discount code for you, podcast30, gets you 30% off anything your heart desires at Savannah Spirit. They have gorgeous yoga clothing, jewelry, stones, crystals. This week I'm featuring their chakra mini gemstone bracelet set. It's so beautiful. It's seven little bracelets, and they all have the different healing stones for each chakra, which just is really relevant for today's conversation as we talk about energy. So I encourage you to check that out, and let's dive back into our conversation with Karena. So we're back with Karena, and where we left off in Tuesday's episode is we were talking about this idea of samskaras, or our subconscious patterning, living not just in our mind, but also in our energetic field. Karena, did I say that right?
Yes.
And you wanted to share a story with us about how you had this big breakthrough when you sort of realized that just doing kind of like mindset work isn't enough, that we need to actually go into, you called it the epigenetics, the unfinished subconscious patterning that maybe is not even our own or from our own childhood, that could be from our ancestors. So do you want to share that story with us now?
Sure, I do. When I had my children, I wanted to have a third child, and I decided that I would. And I was reading all these great books on the law of attraction and how you could think your way into anything and everything. And I got pregnant, and my father was very sick, and my stress level was so high. And even though I was thinking all these positive thoughts, even though my dad was sick and I was doing all my, you know, intention work, and I was lining everything up in terms of, you know, my vision board and this and that and the other thing, my sympathetic nervous system was in overdrive, and the energy field around me was just wonky, as full of trauma from what was happening to me in that moment.
So you were already a pretty devoted teacher and practitioner at this time.
Yes. And I was also helping women with fertility, and I was showing women how to get pregnant, and many of them would get pregnant. So I was like, oh, wow, I got this. I'm going to get pregnant myself, and this is going to be great, and I'm going to think positive thoughts. Now, what I didn't realize was that the women that were getting pregnant you know, obviously were having their own sense of miracles, but they weren't going through something so traumatic at the time as what I was going through. So I ended up just thinking my way through it, though. And anyway, I got pregnant and my father ended up dying. And during his funeral, I had a miscarriage, literally during his funeral. And it was such an awful, awful experience because I felt like the biggest failure. And I would go back to my fertility classes while I had a belly and pregnancy classes because I taught both. I had a belly. I had to go back and say, I don't have a belly anymore. And here I am like the fertility guru, right? And the universe said, ha ha, that's what you think, right? Who do you think you are? Yeah, you know, you're the Kundalini Yoga fertility guru. Well, I'm going to humble you. And talk about humility. It was not only humbling, it was devastating. And I felt like my whole world was falling apart. So I had, it was a little girl who never made it. You know, she wasn't fully full little girl, but her soul was certainly there. And we still, you know, talk to her and communicate with her. And sometimes my daughter even sees her in her dreams, which is very beautiful. But what I realized was that I went back to all the things I was doing and all the things that I was taught as well. And I had, you know, like I said, I've been practicing Kundalini Yoga for many years. So I felt like there was something missing. What was I not recognizing? And when I started to recognize, when I started to realize that I wasn't utilizing this energy field, I was getting so caught in my mind that I wasn't allowing the flow to happen from the energy field. I wasn't allowing the healing to happen from the energy field. And I started to do a lot more research and a lot more studying on how that field is actually in many ways more important than our minds. Our minds will constantly hold us back. Our minds keep us in those holding patterns. Our minds bring up fear. Our minds are constantly wanting to be in the driver's seat. But when we let our energy body and our intuition that comes from the energy body and our heart, which is highly connected to the vibration of the energy body, when we let those things lead the way, we're actually allowing our soul to have the experience. So that experience humbled me so much that I realized I needed to go back into my work. And I was very open and upfront with a lot of the people I was working with. And I said, I feel like a failure. And, you know, I feel like, you know, bullshit. I thought that I had this and I didn't have it. And, that was really beautiful. It was, talk about complete humility. It was very humbling. And now I also operate from a place of really seeing that every single person has their own answers within them. And I just am, you know, a conduit for helping people find their answers within them. I don't know anymore what somebody knows for themselves. So that guru, that true teacher, that true guru is within us and beyond. And beyond meaning in that fifth layer to and then to heaven. So a teacher can work in the first layer, right? Or a teacher can help you recognize the other layers, or a healer can work in the other layers. But if we're just working with words and we're just working with the mind, we are bypassing the magic of the field. And in that field is where the divine says, everything is at your fingertips. Can you activate it now? I want to give this to you. I want you to have this. And as we know, we have all these beautiful guides with us that are in the heavens or wherever we want to say they are, whether it be the trees or it be in heaven. To me, I say God, I say heaven, I say angels, but everybody has their own language on this higher realm. And those incredible manifestations of the divine are always conspiring to bring us everything we want in our lives. And I'm sure many people on this call, I'm sure of this, many people on that are listening right now have angels that brought them to this moment that are saying, this is what I'm talking about. Because maybe people are saying, why isn't it working for me? When will it be my turn? When will it happen for me? How many more times do I need to watch? How many more times do I need to see someone on Facebook with their belly popping out? Or how many times do I need to see someone on Facebook with their you know, beloved in their arms, you know, holding their lover or on vacation doing this or having their dream job or making money? And when we stop comparing ourselves and we stop going into any form of competition and we go into our humility, because humility is really important. And we just say our prayer into that energy field. And we set our intentions from the heart to send light into that entire field all the way out to the heavens. We create the space for all these beautiful guides to come right in. And they do. And the light just becomes a magnetic force, and more and more and more light comes in. Not that we don't struggle, because that's what we're here for. We're, you know, living in life. We're not living in heaven. We're living on the earth realm. So there's going to be things. But what happens is the struggle becomes more of a way of recognizing it's an opportunity. And it's more of a way of, how do I turn this mountain into a miracle? How do I create alchemy? Because a lot of this is alchemy. A lot of it is electricity. A lot of it is, transmuting energy. So, and it's not woo-woo. I mean, this is scientifically backed up in many ways. They've done tremendous amount of work scientifically on this, on what we know. I mean, look at how we have these computers that we're listening to right now. Years ago, people would say, what? You know, or FaceTime. I mean, I remember when I was a little girl, someone said, one day you're going to be on the phone and you're going to be able to see the person. And I was like, no way. You know, and now it's like my niece, I get on the phone with her and I'm like, hi, you know, here's Auntie Kina, you know, and she's right there. I'm right here. And I think, gosh, this is amazing. So what about flying in an airplane? All of these people, all this weight that are elevated in the sky. Think about before that was around. People would say that person's insane. They think that they're going to be able to get a bunch of people and they're going to actually elevate from the ground. That person's insane. So in my life, many times people have said, you're like really out there, you know, like that's really out there. And my husband, you know, it just kind of giggles at me now because I do say things that are really out there, but they're not. They're not out there. They are more real than our struggle. They are so much more real than our struggle. I saw so many miracles just today. Today's been a really long day. I won't get into the details of that. But and if I didn't have the right mindset and the right, you know, and the right meditation practice in the morning to really kind of put that golden egg around me, it might have been a difficult day. But I saw every moment as an opportunity and a beautiful gift. And right now, as I'm talking to you, I know I had this planned with you, so I wanted to keep it. But right now I have a whole bunch of family members in our kitchen, and we're celebrating that, you know, something really beautiful happened with someone in our family that we didn't know would be beautiful this morning. But the whole entire day, even from the moment I woke up this morning, I said, this is going to be a beautiful day. And I put that intention not only in my mind, I put it into my energy field, and I opened my heart and I just started sending love, and I started visualizing light around all the people who need it. And the miracles are so incredible. And there's been butterflies. So many things have happened. And it's my side of the family and my husband's side of the family in the kitchen with our kids, just celebrating the beauty of family and togetherness. Because when you go through something difficult where you think you could lose someone in the family, and then you see that they're okay, you really bond, you connect. And in my opinion, it's the energy fields that connect. So it's this blissful feeling that I experience because I see this connection and I strive for connection in everything in my life.
So Karena, I want to thank you for sharing the story that you shared with us. I think it's what you're talking about is exciting. And I want to make sure people can have a sense of how they can do this, how they can do what you're talking about. So can you tell us a little bit, like, what did your Kundalini practice look like? Because it sounded like you were a devoted, not just practitioner, but teacher, right? So what was the shift that happened in your practice? Because you mentioned here a morning practice. Like, what was happening when, you know, before you had this realization? And then how was the practice different after? Because I'm assuming you're probably doing the same poses, maybe even the same meditations. But my guess is that you had a different awareness layered on to the practices you were doing it. So can you tell us about that?
Oh yeah. I was completely in my head, and I was completely in the mode of, let me time this. Let me make sure it's 11 minutes. Let me make sure I'm doing it the right amount of time. Oh my gosh, if I do this wrong, something's going to happen. What if I missed an exercise in the Kriya? What if I taught this wrong? What about if a student doesn't like me? What about if I don't succeed in helping this person get pregnant? What about if? Now, I don't go there at all. I just show up. I open my heart. I close my eyes. I open my eyes. I look at everybody. I send everyone love from my eyes into their eyes. I smile at them all. I look. I observe. I see what kind of blocks I might see in the energy field. And before I even get to that place, I do my own sadhana practice every single day where I set the intention to heal and love and honor every layer of these fields, including the parts of myself that maybe I don't necessarily like, you know, like, oh, I don't like that I was really judgmental yesterday. Because like for me right now in my life, I've become extremely judgmental. And a lot of that is for political reasons. My vibration from politics has really, I've been struggling with overcoming judgment and trying to justify that I'm just being discerning and that's discernment. But I have some anger in that. So I'm working really hard on, before I even leave my house, creating alchemy. How can I open my heart and love and let the love that I share dissipate some of this judgment that I'm feeling, right? And dissipate some of this pain that I'm feeling for the world. So I do all of that before I show up. And then when I'm there, if someone gets up and, you know, as I was saying on our last call, if someone gets up and rolls up their mat and leaves, I just make sure they're okay. And then that's it. If someone, you know, lashes out at me or I get backlash or something, I really am able to say, okay, it's all right. And if someone loves me so unconditionally and says, you are a saint, you are an angel, okay. I don't allow my ego to run the show on anything. I allow everything to come from my heart and that energy field, and also my hands. And I've noticed that even my hands have this healing that comes through them now that I never, you know, over the past maybe 5 years, that I never really understood. And it's this unbelievable warmth that comes out of them. But if I go into my mind and I start thinking things like, maybe I'm not good enough, or maybe I taught a really bad class, or who do I think I am? Or shame on you, Karena, for, you know, driving too fast and almost going through that stop sign or whatever it is, then I'm in my head again. And that's when I have to go into the energy field to break free of those patterns, because I happen to be, by birth, an extremely sensitive person. And I have had to work really hard in my life on overcoming insecurity. And I open up honestly about that because a lot of people don't know that about me. Even when I was younger, I was able to hide it a lot. But there's this insecurity that comes from ancestors, for sure. Because no matter how much work I've done on myself, I wasn't able to overcome it until I got out of my head. And I embraced that energy field and healed it.
Karena, what are your thoughts on like past life regression and the Akashic records and some of those other things that you hear people exploring or kind of unpacking as part of this whole past life work that oftentimes people get interested in?
Okay. I love it. I think it's fascinating and fabulous. I believe in all of that. I believe I believe that there are many avenues to the divine. There are many, you know, there are many streams and rivers, whatever, you know, that meet in the same place. There are many paths to God, or however we want to say it, but there isn't one size fit all. It's different for every person. And I happen to embrace all of them. I even celebrate I celebrate spiritual existence through energy. So if there's a Jewish holiday and I'm in an area where I know that there's some people that are actually, you know, having a tradition of their family over, and I feel that and I go, oh, I feel so much light. Oh, I know why. It's a Jewish holiday, because there's the collective.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the relationship between the energy body, the heart, and intuition, because I feel like I've heard you talk about these three things throughout our time together. And I'm wondering how they're all interconnected and how they're related. Like you say, like you send energy into your heart, and that seems like synonymous with sending it into your energetic field. Or, you know, in Kundalini Yoga, we're always focused on intuition, right? Rolling the eyes, you know, internal gaze into the third eye center. How do all these things interplay with one another so people can maybe try to work with this themselves at home?
Yeah, great question. So yes, you want to focus on the third eye point, because that is the pituitary gland area. That is the point of intuition. So that is your intuition that your mind understands. Okay. So that's the intuition that your brain can actually send messages of, oh, there's something here. This is, you know, because the mind does have wisdom. And so that's your intuition based on maybe, you know, situations in life where you realized, okay, I don't really remember it, but I can remember a little bit that when I did that, that wasn't necessarily fear-based, but it was more that, you know, maybe it wasn't the best thing to do and it didn't really feel so good. So maybe I'm not going to be doing that. And your intuition will kind of read upon that based a lot on these, the storehouse inside of the mind, right? So you can make a decision based a lot on the mind. Now you're also integrating a lot of aspects, but other aspects energetically and of the heart, but a lot of that is the way the mind can cognitively make a decision. Now the heart, totally different, because the wisdom of the heart is different than the intuition. The wisdom of the heart is more of feeling body, the knowing. And if you think about when a baby's conceived, the heart beats way before the brain is even developed. So there's that beating heart, and that beating heart is happening because some scientists believe that there's a tiny little area that has the same mechanism of cells that a brain has inside the heart. So there's like a brain heart, a heart brain. So that heart, right, is doing its own thing. And that heart is so alive before we're even formed. So that is the place of love. And the way that we work through anything and everything in life, and the way that we can heal, is through love. Love is the highest of all frequencies, and the vibration of love, so incredibly magical that when we choose, drop into the heart, everything we do will be based on love. Everything we do, because if it's coming from the heart, it's only going to be based on love. The mind can interject, but the more we drop into the heart, the more that there's that feeling that goes through the body, where the body just goes, yes. And there's more of a sensation in the body of yes or no. You know, and there in time you start to recognize, oh gosh, my shoulders are up to my ears. Is this no or is this fear? And then you start to ask yourself, and this is where, you know, a lot of other things can come into play, like using a pendulum or different things like you know, even using your body as a pendulum to make decisions. Now that is where the energy comes in. So that's why if someone else holds a pendulum and asks it a question for you, that's not your heart, that's not your intuition. That is your energy field. So does that answer your question?
It does. I'm wondering if you have some tips for people listening, like how do you know when you're coming from your head and when you're coming from your heart?
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's a challenge that people are experiencing right now in many ways. Even people on a spiritual path who have been on a spiritual path for a really long time are feeling very confused right now because the information overload that's coming through between technology and also these downloads that are coming through from the higher realms in order to bring the shift to our universe is so overwhelming that people are kind of almost getting a little bit paralyzed with, I thought I had more intuition, but I can't make this decision now. So quiet the mind, deepen the breath. When you deepen the breath, you soften the entire body, you stimulate the parasympathetic nervous system, and then send love from your heart out into your energy field and set the intention that your decision will be based on the vibration of love. And keep breathing, quieting your mind, keep focusing at the third eye point, eyes are closed, eyes are rolled up and inward with them closed. Keep that process going until you start to get clarity. And then what's happening is you're integrating the clarity of your energy field, clarity of your heart, and the clarity of your intuition. Sometimes what I recommend people do, if they still are not clear, after they do that, and I mean it could take 20 minutes if you really have a big decision to make. It could take 3, it could take 1, it could take 11 minutes. I'm using numbers that we use in Kundalini Yoga, the 3 minutes, the 11 minutes, 31 minutes. That's a whole nother topic in itself, but you don't have to use those numbers, but those are basically the sacred numbers that we do use in Kundalini Yoga for timing. But anyway, so you integrate it all, and then you, if you still are not able to make the decision from your energy, your heart, and your intuition, this is what I recommend people do. Let your body tell you. And the way you do that is you ask the question, and if your body moves forward, it's yes. If your body moves back, it's no. And in that moment, it could be the smallest movement, and you will notice that your body will move forward or back, even just a little bit. Sometimes for me, it's a lot, and I go, whoa. Okay. And then I don't let my mind come in, because the key is you can't let your mind come in after that, because you've just integrated mind, intuition, heart, energy field, body, the divine, And in that moment, all those aspects are working for you. So there's your answer.
And for people practicing at home, do you think if they just have an awareness of the five layers that we talked about on Tuesday and this awareness of the electromagnetic field and trying to really project from the heart, is that enough? Like, is that enough? Or do they also need to like get past life regression therapy and, you know, work with someone one-on-one to unpack some subconscious stuff that may be going on? Or is it enough just to have awareness and radiate light into this energy space?
I think it depends on the person. And I think, again, that's very individual, right? Because for some people, it absolutely could be enough. But I know people who do it all. It also depends on how much trauma someone has been through in their lives or how much trauma their ancestors have been through. It can also have a lot to do with, you know, how much trauma they're in right now in their lives. I did just do a course with Yoga Journal, which is Kundalini 101, Create the Life You Want. And in that course, which is an online course, and they priced it pretty reasonably as well. In that course, a lot of this is talked about. So if somebody wants to, and you also get my free book with that course too, which is Essential Kundalini Yoga, where a lot of this is discussed. So there's more of an ability to you know, understand a lot of these concepts in a much broader way, because obviously we had two, you know, brief chats about this. And in that, really following whatever you need. I am not someone that says, Kundalini yoga, that's all you need. I know some people do say that. I think that there's many, many modalities that are integrated at this time. I also am not someone that judges, you know, medicine. So I feel very strongly in, I feel very strongly in this belief that God, because I call the divine God, that God created everything for us. And it's up to us to decide what is best for us. And nobody else can tell us what that is. No book, no manual. And at this point in the world, at this time in the world, there isn't even a guidebook. There isn't a manual. We can't even find one. So that's why a lot of people also are like, oh my gosh, what is this? And I say, you got to find out for yourself, because that's what the energy is. The energy is saying, what do you feel? And how do you find the guru within yourself? And how do you activate your highest potential without someone else being there to do it for you?
If someone tries, yeah, it says, if someone tries Kundalini yoga, because I have this, people ask me about this all the time on social media. If someone tries Kundalini yoga and has a very bad adverse reaction, right? Like they start sobbing or, you know, just not good. What's your take on that? And what's your suggestion for what they should do?
My daughter used to come with me to teach all the time. And then my husband one day said to her, why don't you want to go with mommy, you know, to her workshop today? And she said, I just don't want to see everyone crying. Everyone cries. First of all, crying is part of the purging process and it's part of the rebirthing process. So crying is actually very beautiful. But some people say that they feel really angry. And some people say that they get in a bad mood for the entire day after they take classes. I've heard that from quite a few people. And I say, woohoo, that's awesome. That stuck energy that's being released, you'll move through it. So that irritability that can come with Kundalini yoga is awesome. It's the catalyst that helps you to get to the other side. You know, it's like when you go hiking, you get to a certain point, and you're like, I'm done. Or even if you're exercising, sometimes it's I'm done. And then you get that second wind. It's the same sort of thing. It can create all sorts of resistances. And so it's a matter of getting through those resistances. So that's my take on it. But again, Kundalini yoga is not for everybody. And that's something that I think is really important also, that I know people who don't like Kundalini yoga. And they might say to me, are you going to teach a Hatha class? Because we liked when you taught the Hatha classes, and I don't really teach many Hatha classes anymore. I don't want to come to Kundalini. I just want to come to Hatha. And I celebrate them because that's what's best for them. So again, it's not one size fits all. People who love Kundalini yoga usually love Kundalini yoga. People who are going through a lot of resistances and really don't want to be there, but know they feel great afterwards, I say, give it another go. People who get there and can't stand it and are just can't even get past whatever they're feeling, find something else.
Yeah. And I always tell people they can come back and revisit Kundalini later, right? It's not like they have to do everything right now, right? They can give it a break for a couple years. And I mean, I know that was my experience. I couldn't really handle it at the beginning. And you know, I kind of refound it 6 or 8 years later. This has been so, so fun. Before we let you go, would you mind just sharing with listeners as a last question, what does your personal morning practice look like? Because it sounds like it's really powerful and, you know, really setting you up for your day in a beautiful way. I'm just curious. I always like to ask guests who come on the show, just what does your own practice look like in terms of, you know, are you doing a 40-day kriya right now? Or what's, you know, how are you timing it in terms of asana and meditation and chanting and fitting everything in? I'd love it if you're willing to share.
Sure. Yeah. No, I'm not doing a 40-day meditation. I haven't done one of those in a while. I've been doing the same meditation every day for probably about 7 months now. So this is what I do. I get up in the morning, I put my hands on my heart, and I just thank God for the new day. I look outside the window. I look at, you know, maybe it's still dark out, because I usually get up before the sun comes out, maybe, or up. Sometimes the sun is just coming up. And sometimes I'm starting to see the different colors in the sky, and I start to look at them, and I start to really go into a place of prayer, and I start visualizing light around the people that I love. And then I start to just ask the divine to take away any energy that is not mine, that's not serving me, so that I can really feel good, because I'm an empath and I tend to really let other people's energy stick to me if I don't set this intention. So I do that first, and I'm still lying in bed and I'm still kind of bringing my hand over my heart. And then I start to move my hand around my body and I visualize healing coming through and healing anything that needs to be healed. And then I bring myself out of bed. However, there's no specific way that I bring myself out of bed, but this is not really Kundalini yoga part, but I'm giving my morning ritual. And then I oil pull for 20 minutes. And as I'm oil pulling, I listen to mantra, and I don't necessarily sit and meditate. I might even walk with it, or I might just do something, but I'm in that zone. And then I finish my oil pulling, and then I sit in my meditation. And at that point I chant.
And is that like a 11 minute, 30 minute, 31 minute, or you don't even time it. You're just from the heart. Yeah.
I don't even time it. I'm not a believer. You know, I'm kind of a rebel in that. I sort of, you know, I used to time everything, but then I got so heady. Again, that was part of my wake up call was, I don't need to be so time, you know, I can feel it. I just, and I can sense it. So I don't set a timer, because I find that very distracting. I just do it until I'm finished. Or until there's some distraction. But I always say, okay, that distraction right now is happening for a reason, because I believe everything is in divine order and everything happens for a reason. So if all of a sudden the dog starts barking, or all of a sudden one of my kids gets up early or something like that, it's like, okay, I'm finished. And I did enough. And what I did was beautiful. And maybe I didn't do as much today as I did another day, but that's okay. I am setting my intention to be the best that I can be no matter what. And that's it. And beautiful, I celebrate that. Big thing is to always celebrate whatever it is that we do, even if it's 2 minutes. Now, the key is I do not check my phone. This entire time, I do not check my phone. Even if I use my phone because I want to listen to mantra, I keep it on airplane mode. I do not look at any texts, any emails, any social media, anything. And then I get my kids ready for school and I still kind of stay in the zone. And then I usually, sometimes if I'm done with my meditation before it's time to get the kids to school, I'll get on email or I'll get on text. Sometimes I do work early in the morning, but it's always after I do whatever I need to do to connect with the divine. Sometimes I also will do my work. If I'm going through a really hard time, like, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I went into a lot of judgment, as I was saying before, and I started to feel really angry. And I started to feel like all this activism coming through my skin. And I was going, oh gosh, I don't like this feeling. So I was waking up feeling really out of sorts. So I had to start doing gratitude work. And I had to start doing things of like, please bless all the people who I'm worried about that are, you know, not even people I know, but just, you know, a lot of what's taking place in the world. And then do gratitude. Because gratitude will shift our vibration so that we can get into the place of being able to do the other work.
That's a great tip. Thank you so much for sharing all of that with us. I loved hearing about your morning routine. Tell listeners where they can find and connect with you online. I know you mentioned an online course you have. I know you've also authored a book. So, you know, if they want to get in touch and work with you or learn more from you, how can they do that? How can they connect?
So KerenaVirginia.com, KerenaVirginia.com. And I have social media platforms too. But if you go to KerenaVirginia.com and you sign up for my newsletter, that's the best way to stay in touch with me because I'm actually redoing my whole website. So it's a temporary site, but at least that way you'll get my monthly newsletter. And there's also a way to contact me through the page. And I'm always open to receiving messages, even if my assistant gets them. If someone needs a lot of prayers, please go through the contact page. If my assistant gets it, sometimes she writes a list of people's names and what they need. And I actually find a lot of joy in praying for people. So don't be afraid to do that. I do a lot of service work as well. So I'm all about, you know, giving. And if someone needs help with something or someone's really going through a lot and can't afford something and just, you know, needs some support or a meditation or something, please do reach out to me. That's part of my own meditation practice, is spending about an hour every day, sometime during the day, to give back. So sometimes it's about, you know, people who might reach out to me and who I might, you know, form an email for or pray for, et cetera. So again, www.KerenaVirginia.com.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for being with us and sharing all your knowledge. And I know I took so many notes and I found all of it so interesting. So I'll definitely be sure to connect with you. Savannah family, let me know what you thought of this week's episode and this week's guest. Remember, the number one way you can support the show and keep information like this coming to you is to leave a review here on iTunes. Even if iTunes isn't how you normally listen to the show. And if you're not sure how to do that, because I know it's really confusing, we have a tutorial for you at savannahspirit.com/review. And it kind of walks you through step by step how you can go through the steps on iTunes. It really does make a difference. I'm wishing you a beautiful day full of yoga and meditation. And I know I, for one, will be incorporating some of Karena's morning routine into my own tomorrow. And I hope you will as well. I will connect with you next week, and I'm sending a lot of love. From my heart to yours, namaste.
You've been listening to the Savannah Podcast. To find out more about Savannah, go to savannahspirit.com or follow Savannah on Facebook at facebook.com/savannahspirit. For daily inspiration, check out our blog at savannaheast.com. Be sure to join us next week for a new episode. And thank you for listening to the Savannah Podcast.